All right, number three. How many of you are still with me today? All right. How many of you say, I've never heard anything like this in my whole life? That's all right. Maybe you grow and learn something today. Amen. Number three, consider that the disciples needed the baptism in the Holy Spirit to be effective. What? Yes. You would have thought that after walking with Jesus for 3.5 years, after seeing the miracles, I mean, Lazarus coming out of the grave, right? Bouncing in his grave clothes, blind men are seeing, the deaf are hearing, the mute are talking, after being underneath his teaching, after watching Jesus die, being buried, resurrected from the grave, showing himself alive for 40 days to everybody that, you know, that knew him by infallible proofs that he was definitely alive, and then watching him ascend into heaven, you'd think, wow, this group of people, they're ready to go preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. They're ready to take, you know, the message of Christ to everybody in the world. But that was not the plan of God. How many of you are with me? The plan of God, my friend, was that they were to go, and we can read about this in Acts chapter 1, verse 4 and 5. In fact, these are the words of Jesus. He said this. He said, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift. Everybody say gift. Wait for the gift my Father promised, which you've heard me speak about. Well, what was that gift? He explains it in the very next verse. For John baptized you with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. That's a great gift. Come on. Now, how many of you know salvation is a gift? I'm grateful for the salvation. Come on. Can we give God a big hand for salvation? Amen. It's a wonderful gift. In fact, it says it is the gift of God. Amen. But let me, that's not the only gift that God has, right? And so Jesus was speaking of the gift of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And the question becomes this, okay? Why would Jesus tell the disciples, his apostles, those who were followers of him, there was 120 in that upper room, to wait for something if they had already received it? Amen? And I want you to know that the disciples knew Christ, right? They already knew. They'd walked with him for 3 years. Jesus was a pretty awesome soul winner if we believe John chapter 4. Hello. All right, right? So you can tell by the words that Jesus said that they had already received a gift of salvation. Let me give you a few verses to show you that today. John 15 and verse number 3 says this. He told his disciples, he said, you're already clean because of the word I've spoken unto you. You're already clean because of the word I spoke to you, right? Now, he wasn't talking about physically being clean, right? He was talking about a spiritual cleansing. You've already been spiritually cleansed because of the words that I have spoken unto you. In John chapter 15 and verse number 5, just a few verses later, Jesus began to use an analogy where he talked about the branches, right? Jesus is the vine. We're the branches. If we're the branches, we're in Christ. We are connected to him. We're to remain in him. How many of you know if you're in him, you're in Christ, right? And then they heard Jesus in John chapter 17 pray for all of his disciples. This is what he said. And it's interesting because in this prayer, he says that they belong both to the Father and to the Son, right? This is what he said. He said, I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for the ones you've given me, okay? The ones you have given me, for they are yours. Let me give you another verse that shows us this. 70 of his disciples heard Jesus say, your names are written in heaven. Amen. And so if your name's written in heaven, how many of you know you're right with the Lord? Am I right? Amen. That's a good thing, right? And so Jesus had promised them that he was going to give them a gift. You say, well, what was that gift? John 14 and verse number 16 tells us what it was. How many of you know I'm preaching the word today? Come on. How many of you know you can't argue with the word of God? Come on. John 14 and verse 16 says, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. Amen. How many of you know we need the Holy Spirit? We need the Holy Spirit. In fact, let me tell you something. You need the Holy Spirit even to get saved. Did you know that? It's the Holy Spirit that draws you to Jesus Christ. It's the Holy Spirit. The moment you get saved, the Holy Spirit seals you. Come on, somebody. The Holy Spirit is there to guide us, to lead us. And let me tell you something. There's more to the Holy Spirit because we can be also become empowered by the Holy Spirit. Amen. He is the Spirit of truth. Let me give you another verse. John 14 and verse number 26 says this, but the Counselor, I mean, that's just another name for the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, some versions say, the Counselor, the Comforter, or the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things. Let me tell you something. One of the great errors of the Pentecostal movement is this, is that people have walked around and said, you don't have the Holy Spirit. That's ridiculous. You can't get saved without the Holy Spirit. Amen? But let me tell you something. There is another experience that is subsequent to salvation whereby the Holy Spirit empowers you. Come on. I don't know about you, but I don't have everything that I need to be able to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. I don't have what I need. I need the power of the Holy Spirit in my life. I need Him to flow through me. I need Him to be in me. Come on, somebody. I need His touch in my life so that when I'm sharing the gospel, when I'm living my life out in the world, my light shines brighter than ever. Come on. Somebody give Jesus a big hand for asking the Lord to send, asking the Father to send the Holy Spirit. We need the Holy Spirit. Now, there's a whole lot to this subject, all right? That's why I'm kind of taking this in pieces, all right? Next Sunday, I'm going to preach a message, and I want to invite you back. Please don't get scared away today, all right? I want to invite you back to this message that we can understand the role of speaking in other tongues. And a lot of people get really freaked out when they say, what? You're going to speak in a what? You're going to do what? Huh? You're gonna, you talk in other languages? Is it in the Bible? Is it in the book of Acts? That's all I'm asking. And so I'm gonna talk about that, all right, next Sunday, all right. But I want you to, let's take a look at what had happened on the day of Pentecost. How many still with me, all right? Jesus had died. The disciples had scattered. He rose from the dead. They went back together. Jesus showed himself alive. He told them to wait in Jerusalem. And so they had gathered there together, praying, seeking God for some time. And who were those that had gathered? These were the most dedicated, hungry Christ followers that there were. These people wanted everything that God had for them, right? Acts chapter 2 and verse number 1 says this. It says, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. And they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. And all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. God showed His power in that hour and poured the Holy Spirit out. And let me tell you something. That was the start of a mighty move of God. That very day, Peter stood up and preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. That first Spirit-anointed sermon caused 3,000 people to come into the kingdom of God. And from there, the kingdom of God began to grow. It began to spread. Even though many people tried to stamp it out, tried to persecute it out, let me tell you something. They could not put the fire of the Holy Spirit out because they took that message around the world. Amen. Until, even as I said a couple of weeks ago, that even the enemies of Jesus said, wow, these people who turned the world upside down, they came here as well. Amen. Let me tell you something. We need the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Amen. Number 4. How many of you are still with me today? Don't tune me out. Number 4. Consider that it was the common experience for believers in the New Testament. Common experience. I want you to understand that you can pick up the Bible and you can read from Acts chapter 2 to Acts chapter 19. If you're a slow reader, it might take you 3 hours. If you're a fast reader, hour and a half. You can read that in just a short period of time. But let me tell you, that was not a short period of time from Acts 2 to Acts 19. That was 20 years later. Acts 19 came 20 years after the day of Pentecost, all right? And so look what it says in Acts 19 and verse number 1. It says, while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul took the road through the interior and arrived at Ephesus. There he found some disciples and asked them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? They answered, no, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. So Paul asked them, then what baptism did you receive? John's baptism, they replied. Paul said, John's baptism is a baptism of repentance. He told the people to believe in the one coming after him, that is in Jesus. And on hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And it goes on to say, when Paul placed his hand on them, notice what it says, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in tongues, and they prophesied. Now, I'm just preaching and teaching what the Word of God says. 20 years later, this would happen to about 12 different men in all. It was the normative experience for Christians to receive what is known in the Scripture as the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Wow, Paul finds these guys. All they know is John's baptism. He explains the way more perfectly, and then he prays for them, and they all receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit. That's 20 years after. Amen. It was a normative experience for them. Amen. Number 5. We're pressing right through this today.